This first song is entitled Lemar Shongo. And that's my son's name. So this is named after my second born, so my youngest son, Lemar. It's a really kind of sweet song with a beautiful melody that really captures the person he is on the inside. And it has a few twists and turns on the way, which also is just like Lemar. So, I hope you enjoy it, and if you have any questions about it later, I'll be happy to answer them. Thank you.
moderate. Who wants to be the courageous and inquisitive soul to ask the first question? Someone's got to do it. All right, thank you.
When the song was it originally written for one person? And if not, then how do you adapt it to the other instruments?
Well, like I said, it was written for my son, Lemar. And it's no, we were talking about that earlier, our music is, we have a common language that we can all adhere to, and I sent him the music, and then we kind of corresponded, and everything worked out beautifully.
Did you have a specific instrumentation in mind when you first came up with the tune? Because the instrumentation on the recording is different from this, for example.
Right, on the recording, I have Del Carnes playing organ. And also have a kung player, Omar Hill. And the percussionist at the end of the song, was the part where the percussionist would do the solo and we would kind of vamp underneath of that. So since we don't have a percussionist, then I suggested that Noah and I do that at the end. I kind of exchange ideas at the end over the vamp. And also had a saxophonist, tenor saxophonist, Olivia Pope, played portions of the melody with me, and let's see, who else? And, you know, bring the trap drummer, and yeah, it was a full ensemble.
Yeah. Does that answer, your question? Thank you. Who's next? The ice has been broken, yes.
Who did you hear that made you choose the guitar? Like, who were your influences?
Well, there were these guys who used to come over the house to visit my stepfather. And they played by ear, and they just kind of, they would like fold matchbook covers to make picks and you know stuff like that, and they played by ear. So when I asked them, can you please tell me how you do that, and they said, well, we're just playing by ear, we can't teach you, but I really got a kick out of listening to them, and I always remember the folded matchbook covers. I've been there. I've substituted all kinds of things for guitar picks in my time. And then I started listening to What's Montgomery, and tried searching different players out on jazz radio. But you know, at that time there wasn't really a lot of jazz radio. So, and then my mother, I had a guitar that my stepfather had given me, and she would put it in the closet, kind of hide it from me, because she didn't want me to be a rock and roll player. So she was like, when I would bring it out, she told me, she confessed later. She said, you know, I used to just put it in the closet so you wouldn't think about it. And then she sent me to camp one year, and there were these young ladies there that were playing. We had a talent show, and they were playing the guitars and strumming away. And I said, shoot, I could be doing that now. So when I went home, my Aunt Marlene helped me. She got me a teacher, and my grandmother got my guitar case and my music stand, and they supported me. And then later I saw Joe Beam, and told him it's called Carlos Joe Beam on television. And I hurried up and I ran and I got my mother. I said, look, see, you know, you can play other things with a guitar. It's not all rock and roll. And she said, oh, okay, all right. So it kind of broke the ice for her.
But did you want to play rock and roll?
Not really. I wanted to play jazz. I mean, she used to listen to Nat King Cole recording. I mean, those were kind of the only recordings we had, was Nat King Cole. And I think we had one Fats Domino, a 45 record that was red. So I really enjoyed that music. And, my first teacher was actually a folk guitarist, so she taught me a lot of folk music, and so some of the things that I write, I kind of mix the genres together, the folk music with the jazz, and I do like to rock out every now and then. A little distortion never hurt anybody.
So you were listening to Nat King Cole before he became a singer?
No, this is when he was a singer.
The earlier, were you exposed also to the earlier Nat King Cole when he was?
Primarily it was the vocals, but I mean, he was definitely playing piano on the recording, so right. I was definitely exposed to his piano playing
as well.
Well, he had a good guitarist with him.
Yeah,
early on.
I didn't really pay a lot of attention to the guitar, so I really can't speak on that. In my mind, I'm not really hearing that.
Yeah, so it's primarily the music that was inspiring, right. Not so much the instrument. So.
Right. I know. Well, I want to ask, because your first, and I'm sorry, Sal, I'll get to your next one.
We'll talk about the form of that piece just a little bit, because clearly it's not, you know, a 12-bar blues or a 32-bar song form.
No,
I like that little detour with the four measures of three that you kept throwing in there, but right. Just, you know, a little bit about that.
Well, it's not a traditional form. And when I write thinking of the melody, and I don't think of form until after it's done. So the melody kind of dictates the form for me, you know. And I'll say, oh, hey, there's a couple bars of three, four in there, you know. But that's the way I heard the melody, and so that's how I arrived at that. It's rare that I think about a form, you know. And a lot of times people, when they're reading my music, they say, oh, wait a minute, this is a little different. and some people have a problem with that, but that's the way I write. Yeah. Go from the feeling, the melody, then I think about all the technical things afterwards.
Right on. Do we have any more? Yes, Chris.
I noticed that when the bass player was soloing, you and Noel were playing, comping at the same time. Is there like a certain, like, way you go about doing that, the way you think about comping at the piano player?
Well,
I'm just going to interrupt for a second for those who are less hip to the jazz lingo. comping refers to rhythmic and usually improvised playing of chords to accompany somebody. So somebody's strumming a guitar on a folk tune with a really regular pattern is accompanying somebody with chords, but not really comping because it's rhythmically repetitive, whereas the kind of syncopated and varied chordal accompaniment that you hear a lot in jazz is called comping. As for guitar and piano comping together,
yeah, that's a really delicate situation. Honestly, I've had some piano players tell me to just shut up. but you try to be complimentary and not step on each other's toes. Basically, it's like having a conversation with another person. You know, you try to be very respectful of their voice and try to, you know, get your word in there at the same time. So, basically. And then sometimes you just lay out. You just let the piano have it, or the piano lay out, just let the guitar have it. There's different type of voicings you can use also that aren't as intrusive to what the piano player is playing. So there's a lot of ways to approach it.
What people will do sometimes is have the piano, and sometimes this is improvised and sometimes it's predetermined, but the piano and the guitar will each take on, in that situation, a different role. So they're both playing chords, but rather than both simultaneously improvising, like, do you want to demonstrate like a few bars of Freddie Green, like, pattern on an F major or something?
Freddie Green, he was like,
So the guitar will just keep a really regular rhythm going while the piano will So there are techniques like that where the piano will play high and the guitar will play low to kind of build something into the structure that will lessen the possibility of stepping on each other's toes. But sometimes you just do it like we did it, go without a net and just hope that we're being sensitive enough to one another to.
When you're working with two instrumentalists like this, I mean, it just kind of goes unspoken. They know how to stay out of each other's way and still accompany me so I don't feel like, oh my God, I'm getting bombarded by companies. So, but yeah, because they can sit, I mean, two people who don't know what they do are doing can kind of sit in the same register, you know, a piano player and a guitar player, sit in the same register and play different alterations on their chords. Like one could be playing natural nines and the other could be playing sharp nines, and it gets to be messy if people are not listening. And so there's a certain amount of just, they know how to listen and know how to stay at each other. Like, oh, your Noah's playing this alteration, let me add that to my chord, or vice versa, you know? So there's a lot that they're doing that looks like it's just effortless, but they're listening to each other pretty hard.
Right. So it's both a combination of skill and sensitivity, because you could know how to do that, but still, not unlike conversations that most of you have probably participated in at work, or been passive observers of and tried to participate in before, where somebody's bulldozing everything and maybe has the capacity to be interactive, but is not actually paying enough attention to bring about that outcome. Yes?
Well, following some of this discussion, I'm wondering about tonight's actual levels set on your
amplifiers.
Amplifiers. Mm-hmm. About complementing each other among the three of you, and my personal sense is that I'm getting a lot of guitar and not enough piano through much of the music. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering if that was your intention to have the guitar sound be much stronger than the piano and much.
Please say no, I'm too loud.
Perhaps a wee bit or okay. Piano. Are you on? Okay. You know, somehow.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, when we were rehearsing before, I felt that I was actually overpowering the guitar a bit, and so the lid was all the way up, and I lowered it down to here. Part of it, realistically, is that if we follow the path of the guitar amp, it's pointing directly.
Yeah, maybe others will
good.
And then, the other thing is that when people are in the room, it changes.
It's also changes
the dynamics.
When we were rehearsing, it was bouncing off the walls of an empty room, and so I think, and a lot of it, you know, it's interesting playing playing jazz versus playing rock, for example. One aspect, when I've performed, I don't know if you guys have had this experience, but if I've performed at, say, a festival where the people doing the sound are primarily doing rock bands, and then there's a jazz band that plays, the sound person generally, in a rock setting, has more agency over what's going to happen. So if it's time for the guitar solo, the sound person turns up the guitar. Whereas jazz musicians are used to playing in a more acoustic setting where we're adjusting to one another. So I'm playing at a level where I can hear Monnette. And but yeah, it's a challenge. So I guess part of the answer is
I'll turn down a little bit.
And then I may play softer to compensate. Yes, David.
I have a different kind of question for you. Being a woman, was there the typical challenge that women have breaking into or building a career as a jazz guitarist?
Yeah, a little bit. I would say yes. how I handled that was I started my own band, and you know, sometimes you just can't sit around waiting for people to hire you. You just have to do your own thing. So that's pretty much what I did. And that's pretty much how I've survived the business, I would say. Now there are a lot more women and young women playing very well, and that are getting involved in different bands and things like that. But you know, back in the day, they say, the guys thought that women were a lot of trouble on the road. And you know what? It probably so, because guys cannot just stay away from women. So, I mean, that caused the trouble, actually. But we got the blame. So basically, that's pretty much how people thought. But you know, I loved it. I don't think about it. I don't dwell on that. And because I love what I'm doing, and any opportunity I have to do it, I will do that.
Did you? I guess I'm curious about a variation on that. Did you also get? I mean, obviously now you're respect. Well, obviously I perceive that you're a respected enough musician now that you don't get people judging your music because of your gender. Was that happening initially?
I still have people come up to me and say, "I've never seen a woman play, you know, like that." And it's like the same thing they said to me like back then. And I went on this, there was an orchestra called the Change of the Century Orchestra, and we had a concert in Berlin, and I was, you know, I was making rehearsals and things like that, and I was coming from a teaching job, so sometimes I would be just a little bit late, but the nice thing is that there was a musician friend that said, "Look, they're trying to get rid of you, so just make sure you get here, so don't give them an excuse, you know, to fire you." So I did that, took that advice. And then when we got to Berlin, one of the promoters, he was just kind of, I think he said it out loud before he really even thought about it. He said, "God, these guys, they kept telling me that you were going to be the big problem here, and you're the coolest one here. You got the problem." And I looked at him, because at that time, I had been, you know, around these guys for like many years. And I was like, "Really? Still? It's like that? Okay." So, yeah, anyway.
I think we should play again. The wonderful questions, and we'll take more after this tune.
One, two.
Oh, we should tell them what it is first.
Oh, yeah. This composition I call Something for T-Monk, and that would be Thelonious Monk. So I did write with him in mind and his style in mind. I did not think of the form. All right. Something for T-Monk. One, two.
Thank you.
questions that you held off on or that have emerged as a result of the last tune? Yes, Richard.
You are from Philadelphia, which is, like many cities, used to be a really great jazz scene. You probably know better than I do now. But what is the legacy of Philadelphia jazz? How does it play into what you do, the music you create, if at all?
Philadelphia has, it's like a wealth of jazz musicians, really great jazz musicians. And so they definitely were influential in my playing, and because I heard them, you know, quite a bit and played with them as well. And you know, for R&B, like Philadelphia is the Philly sound, Gambling Huff, and jazz also, I think, has its own kind of groove. A lot of organ players from Philadelphia, really great organ players. A few guitarists, and the saxophonists like Hank Mobley or Dean Folk, and there's like different styles too. You know, the straight ahead music, the traditional sound, and there's what they're calling it now, the outsiders, but they play more avant-garde music, which was, you know, pretty popular in, what was that? That was a long time ago, 70s or 80s. And but that was in New York. But a lot of Philadelphia musicians went to New York for that loft thing, you know, when musicians were really trying to take control of their music and have their own venues in the lofts and concerts. And Philadelphia kind of followed that format and did the same thing to a bit. Now they have a few more jazz places that are opening up. A lot of them closed down, but now new ones are opening up again. And they're bringing in some really nice people and some great music at affordable price.
Do you have current recordings out? I do radio at WWH, and I in fact played your piece from Inner City Records.
Wow.
Time for
change.
Yeah, I played that last night, and you also did an interesting date with Sonny Murray. So talk about that session. That was a very interesting session. Apple Records.
Yeah.
Talking about Philly and the various flavors. I mean, Holding Poker, Sun Ra, The Train. I mean, wow.
Exactly.
Jimmy Keith, you know, crazy. Yeah,
so Sonny Murray, they call him the father of avant-garde drumming. And he is from Philadelphia. He's living in Paris now. And so he had a band called the Untouchable Factor. And it was Conjamal was on vibes, Bart Langister on alto saxophone, and miscellaneous instruments. And I think on that date it was Cecil McVie on bass, I think Frank Lacey was also playing alto on that. So those were like the top, you know, really great players, and I was really excited to be a part of that. Sonny Murray, he did, his music was, he had a lot of different motifs, and they would kind of blend them all together, and then he just kind of went for whatever you were hearing that complemented each other, or not, because it wasn't a feel-good type of listening thing. It was pretty open as to what you could play, and there's a lot of people that really enjoy that music, where you're really just being totally expressive and not constraining yourself to any type of formats.
So flash forward, what do you have out currently yourself?
I have, the last one I did was, it's called Firstborn, and it's featuring an all-women's ensemble, organ, alto saxophone, drums, and guitar, and some vocals. Yeah. But it's more in the traditional sense. It's a funny thing, you know, I was playing that type of music, you know, the avant-garde thing for many, many years. And I had developed a certain style within that format. And then I decided I wanted to work more. So I started playing more traditional things and more blues and things like that. And then I was listening to some older recordings and I'm thinking to myself, why don't you lost that the thing, you know, that I had back then. And so I'm really not trying to recreate that thing, but I'm trying to just bring it back to the forefront a little bit and mix it into what I'm doing now.
Thank you for sharing. Oh, my name is Maurice.
Maurice, thank you for playing those. And thank you for bringing that up.
Yes, Chris.
Do you play differently with a piano player than you with an organ player?
Yes. With an organ player, I really have to punch it out, you know, because they're really swinging and their bass is pumping, and you just get lost in the sauce if you just kind of play too laid back. And so, you know, I did something with Doug Karn, and we were just swinging like crazy, and it really was a lot of fun.
So if there are no burning questions now, we talked about how Monnette brought a bunch of her tunes, but it might be fun to play a jazz standard that we didn't rehearse first. So we talked about the common language of this music, and part of that is shared repertoire. So what happens when people, I mean, for full disclosure, this is the first time tonight that writer Henry or I met Monnette in person. So let's play together. So what happens when we say, okay, well, let's play this tune, and we have a total of a couple hours worth of experience even being in the same room together, much less making music. And it's not magic. It's a shared, I mean, there's magic.
It's
magic, but it's magic that's accessible to anyone who pays the dues to learn the language. So do you want to tell them what it is, or should we just play and tell them after?
Yeah, most people will probably know.
Thank you.
In essence, what it points out is that time is a thing that is, and it is. So drummers don't keep time. It's a myth that drummers keep time. They articulate time, and if they have a good sense of tempo, they articulate time accurately. And if they have a good sense of groove, they articulate time plus that other harder to quantify element of what makes the rhythm feel the way it does. But you take the drummer away, I mean, just if the clock stops, a second still has the same length that it had before the battery ran out on the clock. And so ideally with it, playing in this configuration with players who don't have that kind of solidity can be pretty rough because the drums can help articulate the time for those who don't have a strong enough internal pulse to do so without it. But for me, if everybody in the group shares that same sense of internal pulse, then it kind of doesn't matter what the instrumentation is because the presence or absence of drums is just one element in whether those layers of rhythm are being felt together. You know, when I play a duo with a saxophone player who's got a strong sense of time, every note, even if it's something that's rhythmically obscure, every note is referencing that core sense of time in such a clear and organic way that it's hard to lose track of where you are because it's all in there. I could go on all night, but
and rhythm defines the melody, so you know the melody kind of dictates the time because without rhythm there would be just straight line of notes. So the rhythm actually makes the song and dictates the rhythm.
And we had a question over there, and then a question here.
Yes. I just have a commentary, and I'll reiterate as a wonderful.
Thank you.
When you play so effortlessly, I feel as though I could just do it. And you can. And I know this is outside of your genre, but you've paved the way for Tracy Chapman, you know, India Ari, and so on and so on. So many talk about genders, but you have paved the way for so many, and I'm sure you know that. Mm-hmm. And I just want to tell you that I could just fall asleep.
Is that a good thing?
So beautiful.
Thank you.
Without
the
drum.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. So I think we have one more question, Steve. You get to give us our coda.
Looking at you, I believe, I think you have a very special relationship with your guitar, especially the way you seem to effortlessly caress it both when you're playing and when you're not playing. Is there anything you'd like to tell us about it?
Very special to me. I keep it close by a lot. And I practice in the bed with it. it's just part of my life. It's like a extension of my body.
I actually was wondering about the same. The sound is so beautiful. Is it deeper, or is there something special about that particular guitar? Like, why did you pick that one out when you got it?
There's a long story with that. I was going to Atlanta, and I was taking my guitar, and they wouldn't let me take it on the plane, and it was like a big thing, you know. So you can't take the guitar on the plane. So fortunately, I knew someone working at the airport, and they came and got my guitar and held on to it for me until I got back from Atlanta. But when I got to Atlanta, my friend's husband had a guitar similar to this. And so I used his guitar and his equipment while I was there. And I really kind of fell in love with the feel of it. It's easy to play, it's light, didn't cost a fortune. And it still sounds fantastic. So when I got home, I traded an amplifier for the guitar. And so I play it quite often now. I also have a solo body that I really love, Paul Reed Smith, which costs a lot more money. But this seems to symbolize jazz music, you know, a hollow body, a full guitar, more than the Farbid Smith. So when I play in situations like this, I always use this.
Do we have time for one more? Roland?
I think so, yes, please.
Okay.
Please.
So we're going to close the joint, as they say. Can you call a library a joint, or is that disrespectful? we're going to close this fine community establishment for the night. And if on your way out, please, I'll introduce the cats one more time after we play it. But on your way out, if you visit the place to my left, your right over there, you can buy a number of Monnette CDs. You can sign up on the Resonant Motion mailing list. You can write a note of commentary to the director of the library. You could look out the window into the courtyard. And on your way out the door, if you feel that your pockets are excessively heavy and or you want to see the generous support of the Middletown Commission on the Arts augmented to the point where it fully subsidizes bringing this program to the community, there is a bowl into which you can put your surplus greenbacks. So, do you want to introduce this last song?
Yeah, this last song is titled Other Side of the Gemini, and it's called I Am a Gemini.
Happy birthday.
My birthday just passed, June 5th.
All right.
Yeah. And I'm always happy to see another birthday.
Thank you. Thank you.